the spiritual intellectualism when you're practicing is Rigpa the same as the vision of oneness? Is this what Jesus? No, stop, Paul, stop. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about this. Get used to this blur. This feeling's like so much good news that I'm feel overwhelmed, almost overloaded. See, we think that these intellectual flights of fancy will remove the burn. No, they don't. They do not. Because this is somewhat of an emotional state. It is somewhat of a... I don't feel any emotion, but there is some subtle emotion, I think you could call it. These subtle emotions often play out in our dreams. I've been having extremely good dreams recently. So just because superficially we feel fine, no emotion, calm, doesn't mean beneath the surface that there isn't this super intensity. Super shocking. So the goal is not in practice is to be super shocked like this. So it's not like a contest. Imagine all these devotees around a master and they're trying to, you know, pretend that they're not shocked. Who can hold out the longest? Who can remain? Now, I'm not fazed by anything you say. I get it. I understand it. Yeah. Well, then they're wasting their time there. And the flip side, you see, there's a flip side to it, which I've noticed, is pretending to be shocked by everything the master says, you know. Master, you're so wonderful. You're so incredible. So profound. I'm just so completely moved, you know. That's keeping it all superficial, isn't it? Because if you're really being, and you know what I'm talking about, if you're really being shocked, really being profound, the revolution, you know, it's tough. Tend to be very serious, very sober. It's not some bubbly emotional state at all. So you see these groupies of teachers who are putting on this show of how completely moved they are, so profoundly moved by everything you're saying. It's hitting my heart is just like, you know, I just feel so wonderful. I just, you know, that's not it. That's all acting. That's all pretense. That's all blocking. That's all defensiveness. Because we're hearing such great news that it's just like, huh, what? It's like, what? Or wow, what? We don't know what to say. We don't know what to feel. We don't know what our status is. We're not saying, oh my God, you know, it's just like, what? I feel so moved by what you're saying. It's so beautiful what you're saying. I just love you. It is just so wonderful. It's not that at all. They're not being shocked. They're not hearing what's being said. They're trying to say, look how happy and wonderful I feel right now in your presence. You don't want to ruin that by saying something that might really shock me, do you? No, you don't want to say that. So it's kind of a pleading. Please, don't. I don't want that. I don't want to appear as if I'm not spiritually poised, you know. Remember, in practice, it's not about showing how spiritual poise. You show off your poise by the willingness to be shocked by the good news. Where you're struggling to keep your poise, really. Saying anything. You're not emoting anything. It's way beyond emoting. You're in like almost, you know, pure astonishment. Don't know what to say. It's all blur. Other people might be thinking, well, I'm not blurred, I feel so much love for you, I'm so happy to be here, it's just like fantastic, I really get what you're saying, and I just want to, can I touch you, I just want to look at you, you're so wonderful, you know, and I really totally get what you're saying, I just love you so much, and there's some others are just sitting there like, blurred out, no status, don't know where they are, no status, astonished, tense ordeal. Problem is, when you get that situation where there's these people acting out how spiritually advanced they are and not realizing this is a practice period. Then those who are practicing might start to feel like, you know what, maybe I need to be like those people, you know. So, it's not so good to dissipating an intense sneeze reaction there in the sinus. Became very intense. I was able to dissipate it. Wow. It's not the best idea, in my opinion, to mix crowds, you know, depending where you're at, because those who are too frightened, they act out. They start acting out. And they start acting out. It affects those who are really serious and are able to get with it. This is one way of looking at it. There are teachers now, the big crowds come, the mixed crowds, and there's people from all different, you know, and the profundity of the situation, you know, is so strong that a lot of them start acting out. Becomes kind of a circus, and people get the idea. Well, this is. I need to get it. I need to please the guru by getting it. The guru's saying, "Did you get it?" And of course, some people are saying, "Hey, let me act like I get it," and then the guru will be happy. I get it, guru. You've opened up my heart. I feel so wonderful. And the guru says, "Are you just saying that to please me, or do you really get it?" No, Guru, I get it. I totally get it. What do you get? I don't know what to say, but you're just incredible. This is incredible. And they're acting out, you know, and the Guru keeps grilling them, you know. But it's great theater. It's great theater. But statement. Don't have to complete a thought, do not have to complete a statement, can walk out of the film. Or shift and suddenly no longer worry about valuing of what's the message of the film, because there isn't any message. It's just an honoring of our creativity. Keep in mind, there is no ending to this film. Endings don't exist. So once we've just gotten our honoring of the creativity to a certain extent, we don't need to watch the film anymore. How does the film end? By realizing it never started. How does the path end? By realizing the path never started. Film on existence and realizing that existence has never been. And so this is just purely honoring our creativity. And once we get the sense like, okay, my creativity's been honored, I feel it, there's no reason to watch the film anymore. So the film just continues until no one needs it anymore. That's the answer. How's it end? Well, nobody needs it anymore. There's no momentum to anything. There's no such thing as momentum, actually. Ultimately. But there is a continuity fear. Because if we've been believing in momentum for so long, how do we just shift and realize there's no momentum at all? How does that see? This is another way of looking at why I talk about the continuity fear. Here's a good way of looking at it. Let's say you think everything has momentum. It's all going towards something. It's all meaningful. And then you shift gears to realize it's completely meaningless. There's no momentum anywhere at all. There's only absolute freedom. Just think of how big of a continuity leap that is. What a huge shift that is. And how we're, you know, freaked out about having to make that shift. So if you want to know what's religion really about, it's about evaporating the continuity fear so that shift seems, oh, it's not so bad. Yeah, I can do that. Not a problem. That's all it's about. Religion is an absolute necessity because everyone has to make that shift without exception. No exceptions, no exemptions. What's happening in the world today, it is this belief system that exceptions and exemptions are possible. And those who are manipulating the system have hooked so many people into it. Because they know this weakness we have is this desperate craving for an exception, exemption, because we don't want to go through the discipline and difficulty of the spiritual path of religion, of moving our comfort zone. We don't want to do it. You say, God, can't I get an exemption? So of course, there are those who arise out of our desire for them to arise. A dynamic arises, and there, lo and behold, someone appears saying, I've got an exemption for you. I got an exception for you here. I'm selling exemptions and exceptions. This is all you got to do is, and then they stipulate, you know, what you have to do to get it. They say, well, you gotta earn it. So the tragedy is we end up spending way more time and effort trying to earn an exception, exemption, than if we had just taken the spiritual path, followed the true religion of discipline and practice. We would already recognize, we'd already have the recognition. Instead, we continue to spend vast amounts of effort and attention and everything into trying to earn that exemption and exception. falling into idolatry, desperately asking people, how do I get this? How do I? And then this whole pyramid scheme of disseminating this, how do we, how, the know-how, how to get the exception. Exemption is, that's an entire pyramid belief system of what's called, you know, secular humanist materialism. Everybody then is frantically trying to earn that exemption, then you get this speed up of franticness, like in the Silicon Valley, of everyone thinking that, you know, they're getting closing in on that, earning that exemption, you know, they got their yachts, they got their mansions. These people are, you know, laser focused on, like, I'm going to get that exemption, I'm going to get that exemption. And they're posing like as if they almost got it. You see, you know, the ladies in their spandex leotards with their UGG boots and their blow dry barred hair and look, and their dog on a leash and the whole thing. They say, you know, like I got the exception and exemption, or at least I'm almost there, like that. It's everywhere here. It's everywhere. My God. Some lady came into the store with a dog, big dog, and the dog comes right up to me and like, boom, smashes its face into my leg and all its saliva all over me. I just look at the lady and say, "What the hell are you doing? Can't you control a dog?" She doesn't even pay attention to what happened. And later the dog leaps up on the counter, I mean, stretches up on the counter and puts his paws on my back and shoulders, pushing me. And she goes, huh? Didn't even notice. He doesn't respond to me at all. I'm looking at her like, are you kidding me? Because, it's a hard time controlling this dog, you know. But the whole thing is a whole status entitlement thing. Like, I can let my dog jump all over you and you can't say a thing about it because I know about exceptions and exemptions. This is the attitude here, I'm telling you. It's horrible. It's like living in Sodom and Gomorrah right here. In Babylon. So if they would have put all this effort into the spiritual path, the recognition would already have arrived. You know, they'd already recognize. Now the problem is they say, well, wait a minute. I put all this effort into getting exemption, so I should get, and you're telling me it's worthless, yeah. Well, but because I put all this effort in, I should get some special exemption for the spiritual path too. I should be able to, you know, get the results of the spiritual path without even taking the path. And you see, it becomes a vicious circle then. They say, well, I'm not going to just start at the beginning. Are you kidding? Some of my status and my standing and my exceptions and my exemptions, I should be exempt from the difficulty of the path. I should be exempt from it. And so, its path is very difficult. The more status of you feeling you're exempt from needing to take the spiritual path, the more you feel like, wow, this is really a shame. It's a shame for me to have to do this. I'm so ashamed of having to start, you know, at the beginning and then struggling through all this stuff. Well, yeah, it's difficult. So, you know, sometimes people need to just take the path, you know, on their own and don't let anybody know, like, they're struggling. It's so difficult for them. Not everybody joins a sangha or a, you know, an open path where the struggle is open to everybody. And some people, of course, if you had real high status before, believing you had high status, you feel like, wow, how mortifying that I'm so inept at this, you know. I thought I was really high, and now I'm so inept. It's quite difficult. To go that way succeeds too. It just, it's a bitter pill to swallow when you've put so much effort into attaining an exception or exemption and then finding out that all that effort's wasted. ultimately it's not wasted, because the discipline that you put forth in trying to obtain that exemption, you use that discipline now and turn it around on the spiritual path. So even though it's a bitter pill to swallow, I would say it's quite possible that those who have reached some supposed high status in this pyramid of scheme of exemption and exceptions, which I certainly did, they actually have a certain advantage because of that discipline and determination. It takes enormous effort to, and discipline and determination to try to get up on that pyramid, you know. And so just use that tremendous discipline and determination, the inner drive, use that on the spiritual path. And then you will go really fast and be very successful at it, actually. But it is also true that you will flounder just like everybody else and struggle with it for sure. And it's necessary to do this full stop where it seems like you don't even know what your status is. The idea of status, exemptions, exceptions. See, I don't know. I don't know what my status is. That's difficult, but it's necessary. Problem is, you carry all these attitudes of trying to please this pyramid scheme, secular, humanist, materialist, a pyramid scheme of acceptance and exemptions, and how to please the higher ups, you know. And so you bring all these monkey shines into the spiritual teaching situation, and you embarrass yourself. You don't know how to act because you're trying to seduce the teacher. You're trying to please them, because on the pyramid scheme, of course, it's all about seduction and trickery and deceit and cunning and appearances and, you know, just all this nasty drama and everything. And you think that's how you get ahead, but in the spiritual path, that's not how you get ahead. So people will not know how to act, you know, which is, so what I say is the best discipline is just be quiet. You're not embarrassing yourself that way. Of course, some people will feel that's embarrassing because they're trying to ask like pert questions, you know, like to the teacher. It's like saying, how do I get the teacher to give me an A so I can rise up the pyramid? And then they say, oh, what does the teacher want me to say? Want me to ask intelligent questions? Okay, let me see what kind of questions the teacher want me to ask. You know, it's that whole thing about gaming the system. The modern system is, of course, scholastic, the education, degrees, grades, you know, everything is very much structured. It is what schools did you go to, what kind of degree, a lot of stuff. And so that's the mindset of the world right now. How do I ace this class? And so they'll come with that attitude. That doesn't work. Doesn't work at all. Completely wrong attitude. So they say, okay, the teacher wants me to be quiet. That's how I used to class. Okay, I'm just going to be quiet. Am I being quiet enough? Am I being more quiet than they are? You know, it's so competitive. The schooling system is so hyper-competitive. Everyone's looking at everyone else. What kind of grades did you get? Am I getting better grades than you? Yeah. So am I being quieter than they are? Okay, I don't know if I'm being quiet. So they think that the quiet is some sort of like accomplishment that you just, you know, this is again totally mistaken. What we're talking about is full stop in the now, after being hearing and being shocked by the good news. This is different. Sitting quietly helps the mind concentrate on full stop, but the full stop is a mind thing. It just makes it easier if you're doing a bunch of physical activity. It's very difficult for the mind to focus in on this full stop. For instance, if you're just going about your day and you feel this intense sneeze building up, which I just did, you're going to just sneeze. Really. You can't bring your mind attention. But now, I was able to concentrate my mind just solely on that and have this intense will that this is not happening. And poof, gone. But if I'm active, now I'm going to sneeze for sure. So this is a perfect example of sitting quietly gives you the opportunity. Your mind gives the mind a fighting chance, you see. But it's what you do with that opportunity that's important. It's not just the physical posture of sitting quietly. And so many people are doing their yoga and everything, and they're trying to build up the capacity to get an A in this class, spiritual class. Like, oh yeah, I can come here and sit quietly. I'm used to sitting poised like this. Okay, it's totally missing the point entirely. This is still trying to gain an exemption or an exception. Still trying to game the system, thinking that the credits are up there. You know, I can get the credits, I just have to get high enough status. There are no credits to be gotten. There's no exceptions or exemptions whatsoever from truth, from reality. None whatsoever. We cannot, not only can we not remain indeterminate, we've never been determinate. So people are saying, I want to remain determinate. Can you give me an exception so I don't have to go back to indeterminism? We're not determinate. No one is determined. There is no determinate existence whatsoever. There's no determinate existence whatsoever. And there's no exception or exemption for that whatsoever. So he's got no choice but to learn this discipline. I've been working on it for my entire life, actually, but very intensely for 36 years. Very intense, plus, 36 years plus. That's just, you know, super intense for 36 years. Prior to that, I was also working on it, but I didn't quite have the focus. When I recognized, when I finally recognized my situation here, it's like, uh-oh. And that's when the intensity, the fire of intensity started burning. So, uh-oh, I'm back in delusion. How'd that happen? Wow. Must have never left delusion, right? And we say we're back in it. If we say we're back in it, we never left it. That's why the subtle states after death, that's not free of delusion. That's still in it. As they say, the clear light is the true awareness. The clear light. That's the indeterminate nature of being. So we're working towards gaining recognition of what's called in Tibetan Buddhism Rigpa, Jesus' vision of oneness, value freeness. It's right here. But we're not trying to force it. I just had a little glimpse of how easy it's probably going to be, and so this causes a shock. I say, do I keep trying to force it? No. They say, okay, let me get used to the shock then. The shock of nearness. Okay, the shock of nearness is what we're talking about. I just recognize how close I am really to this recognition. Wow, very close. So the shock of nearness happens. And then I say, okay. Full stop there, shock of nearness. I'm just going to appreciate this. Don't try to forge forward on this. Just, okay, shock of nearness. And of course the mind goes blank and you think, oh, I lost the insight. No, it's near, still near. And I will get it back in a little while, even better, once I get used to the shock of nearness. It's kind of like someone with the eyes closed and they open their eyes a little bit and they see what they want to see is right there, right in front of them. Oh, they close their eyes again, like, oh my gosh, it's so close. Now, if you play it this way, this is how to go fast, really fast. See, because you're not trying to create some subtle state. It's very important. Well, remember, the Dharma is all efforts to free oneself from rebirth, which means you have to see through the subtle states too. So what we're doing here is getting free of all the subtle states. What many do is they intellectualize it and they dissociate in a certain way. And then they go after death of the body, they go enjoy these subtle states, but they're not free of the subtle states. You have to be able to see it here and not dissociate in any way. And see all the states as non-existent, equally non-existent. So this is a different approach. Many take the approach of trying to get into a high afterlife realm. This is not the approach we're taking at all. Which is probably why Longchenpa came and gave me a howdy, because he saw that what I'm working on is to be liberated, truly liberated from even subtle mind. It's definitely a different approach. Seems to go slower, but it's faster, you see, because subtle mind in those subtle realms, you will be reborn into, you'll be cast down into the gross conditioned existence for sure, again and again and again. So how fast is that path? It's not fast at all. Because you realize you really haven't gotten anywhere, you're still being reborn. So this path seems to be slow, but it results in true liberation. And so it is the fast path. So when we get this shock of nearness, we just stop, full stop there. We don't go into some intellectual ism with it, some subtle ism, right? Which is simply saying, okay, the body's dead, but I can dwell in the subtle realm. Right? We're not saying that. Say, no, I'm not dwelling in any subtle realm. The body is not dead. I'm not dwelling in any subtle realm. Not after that. So you sort of use the body, as it were, to get free of the subtle realm. Quite interesting. Actually, being here in this world with this body is actually very helpful to get free of the subtle realms. Very helpful. It's extremely difficult in the subtle realms to get free of the subtle realms. This is what I've been told, and I think there may be some, validity to that. What you basically say is, I'm never going to go back down in the gross conditioned existence, no way. That's a totally unenlightened position, because there aren't any realms at all, actually. So all realms are equally non-existent. And it's pretty easy in the subtle realms to feel all high and mighty by comparison. But that's delusion. So the subtle realms are full of their own delusion, most certainly, chock full of it. So for me, my determination was, I am not coming back at all. So I'm not gonna get free of this whole trap of the sort of cycling through the realms. Forget it. That's all part of, as Longchenpa says, realizing samsara and nirvana are the one and the same. Don't want to get trapped in nirvana. So, as I was able to appreciate Longchenpa's, what his emphasis is, the teaching, his emphasis, I just immediately took to it and said, wow, this is exactly what I'm looking for. Same with the Course in Miracles, Journey Beyond Words. Jesus is absolutely aiming us towards getting free of the cycles of delusional existence, non-existent existence. So, with that in mind, this is why we do this full stop. And we seem to go slow. So I'm talking. I'm giving ourselves us an opportunity to let this shock of nearness, let us settle down a little bit. Let us settle down a little bit. Doesn't have to be completely settled. Let us settle down a little bit here. Just take the edge off of it. Just keep in mind a knife. If you just take the edge off of it a little bit, it won't cut you. You just want to make sure the knife won't cut you, right? So that sharp continuity fear of seeing the nearness to realization, recognition, I said, wow, that's very sharp. Okay, let's dull the blade a little bit. We don't have to wear away all the metal of the blade. Just dull the fine edges. Just take something that dulls it and dulls it a little bit. And then you say, it's like a butter knife now. You say, oh, that's okay. That can't hurt me, just a butter knife. See, in the subtle realms, there's still breath. There's still subtle kind of breathing. Reality, there's no breath at all. It's breathless reality. It's perfect freedom. There's no in-breath, there's no out-breath. Arising and subsiding are the same. As well as non-arising, there's no difference at all between non-arising, arising, and subsiding or non-subsiding. There's no difference between arising or no arising. There's no difference between subsiding and non-subsiding. No difference at all. Again, this is fan the flames. So we have this fire going, and when it starts to die down, and then we fan the flames some more, fan the flames, fan the bellows. We have the bellows here. Fans the flames. So, you know, a teacher's like someone who just has fans the flames, just keeps the bellows going, keeps the fire going, keeps it intense. But we can do that for ourselves. Absolutely. The Holy Spirit will helps us out. Of course, it's difficult when you see the nearness of liberation from delusion. You want to grasp it, but don't even try to grasp it. Just realize, oh, I'm very near. Okay. Let me get used to this fact that I'm very near. I am very near right now towards realization. I'm very close to realization. Just stop with that. I'm very close to realization. I am not a product of the past. I'm very close to realization. If I'm not a product of the past, nor of the future, how far away can I be from what I am? If I'm not a product of the past at all, nor a product of the future at all, how far away can I be? How near? It must be right here. So you say, wow, I must be really close. I am really close. I'm inescapably close. I'm inescapably close to what I am. I am inescapably close to what I am. I am inescapably close to what I am. A little bit of rain, California. A little bit of clouds. Cloudy. It's raining a little bit. It's like, this is like high drama, high theater. Like, what in the world is this? I'm looking at like, wow. Really? I mean, we've gone a couple years without really seeing this type of weather. Hardly at all. And it's just like, what is this? Ground is moist? What is this? But it's just a bare sprinkling. We keep getting all these storms and they just give us a little, a few sprinkles. Maybe the attitude of California, where everybody wants the weather to be perfect all the time so they can go out and get this buzz of nature without, when they think they can that way avoid the spiritual path of dropping your valuing of the world. So you see, the true is only just an honoring of your creativity and the true super beauty of that. They want the weather to be perfect all the time. So maybe collectively we have put a high pressure ridge in place. I know scientists will be freaking out at this, but actually we do control the weather. There's nothing that is outside of us at all. There's nothing ever outside of us. Outside of our mind. There's nothing outside of our mind. There's nothing determinate outside our mind that is causing anything to happen at all. Everything that happens is caused by our mind. By the one mind. This is at such a profound depth of that we cannot relate to it individually, like saying this, what I'm thinking right now is causing the rain or something like that, or causing a drought. But collectively, deep down, there's nothing outside of us. So whatever's happening, it's happening in our mind. Try to stop the burn by trying to call to mind some previous success you've had, because that'll just struggle. Just let the burn be as it is. I feel like I may have got as much as I can right now. I mean, it's just very intense. It's like eating a huge meal. Be aware that you've eaten a huge meal. This is important. Don't disassociate from it. Be aware that this is this huge meal. Wow. Give us some time. I'll see if I can do some more taping later. I know this is a lot. It's an ordeal. But if you knew how the future is being molded and how you're being expected to buy into this future, you would have your hair on fire. Because in no way is that the Dharma. The Dharma is not coming out of Silicon Valley. Except for this, and maybe whoever else is doing, you know, the real Dharma. But the good news is not coming out of Silicon Valley. It's the bad news that's coming out of Silicon Valley. And it's really bad news because it doesn't free you from rebirth. It doesn't free you from the cycles. It's just not, it's not only rebirth in this world, it's just continual cycling. Continual cycling. Contingent cycling, determinate cycling. Belief you're in determinism, this is reinforces your belief in determinism. The only way to remain in this dream of determinism is to keep reinforcing determinism and making it seem like it's positive and progressive. Because your continuity fear says, I can't drop it, I can't drop it. Wow, I gotta keep this momentum going. So in order to keep momentum going, you have to keep momentum going, right? The belief in momentum, which is determinism, you have to keep being progressive, 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 progressive. You can't stop. You feel you're being driven, and you are being driven. You're not the driver, you're being driven. Welcome to the driverless car. Thank you, Google, huh? Well, you're being driven. Okay. The whole thing about this dream is you're being driven. You're being compelled. You feel compulsive. You're being compelled. This is what you want to get, be free of. You try to stop, this world will run you over. Because they got to keep their momentum going, you see. If they don't get to keep the momentum going, they'll start saying, wait, maybe there is no momentum. Wait, maybe there is no determinism. Hey, it's like a house of cards starts falling down. So the whole belief in determinism is a total house of cards. And it's sustained by momentum, the belief in momentum. Now, this gives rise to this extreme continuity fear. So meaning what we have to do is undo this belief in momentum. So we have to have momentum in that way. In that way, pragmatically. Otherwise, we'll get sucked back into the belief in momentum. So we have, the path has to be very brisk, very intense. Otherwise, we'll get pulled, we'll get run over, or get pulled into the belief in momentum. So we have our own momentum as long as we have any belief in momentum. And at some point, we'll be liberated from that, and we won't feel even any compulsion for any more spiritual practice, because we will realize the situation entirely, and then we will simply be inherently blissful, inherently happy, with no sense of needing to produce any momentum for that happiness at all. Which is why you don't need the belief in determinism. You don't need anything to have momentum in order for you to be happy. All right, that's something to consider. All right, great. That's it for this one.